No. I don't drink vodka every day. Anyhow, it's very close. How long have you known each other? You and I?
How long? Now I have to think. You first arrived in this part of the country. When was it? Sonia's mother, Vera, was still alive. And you came twice, both times in winter. It must be 11 years. It could be more.
Have I changed your idea?
Oh, a great deal. You were young and you've grown old. You were a beautiful man. Not anymore. These days you like a drop of vodka.
Yes. 10 years. And there's not a trace left of the man I was. And why? I'm burnt out. On my feet all day long. No time to rest. Even at night, lying there on my blanket, I'm filled with dread that any minute in the truth will hold me out of some sick person. All the years we've known each other, I haven't had a single day to myself. Not one. So of course, I've grown old. My life, same thing, day after day. Quiet. It sits heavy on the shoulders, life. And every single person I meet for miles around is pig-headed. You're surrounded by what you call obsessives, the heads full of ludicrous ideas. Live with them a year or two before you know where you are. You've got some ludicrous idea of your own you're obsessed with. What's to be done? Nothing. It's unavoidable. My brain seems to work right. But my feelings have grown dull. I want nothing. I need nothing. I love no one. Except you, possibly.
Oh.
I love you. When I was a child, I had an enemy just like you.
I'm sure you would like to eat something.
No. During then, the third week, I went to Velitska. The epidemic was raging. Tights. In the huts, the peasants lay on the floor. The depth, the stench. Dark smoke belching from the stoves. Cars fall around the sink. Even figure. The whole day I slogged. No time to put my feet up or eat. Then, at long last, home. Still the rest. They're dragging the signalman from the railways. I lay him on a table. Put him on a chloroform. Open him up. He dies. And at that moment, it's the last thing I need. My feelings come falling back. I tear at my conscience. Kill you. Kill. Sit down. Colorize with this our thought. Those who come after you. Those who live in 100 or 200 years. Those for whom we're preparing the way. Will they have even wondered where the settlers? No, you can count on that.
If people won't say a good word, God will.
Thank you. Well said. Slept well?
Yes, extremely well. This is the professor and his lady wife came to stay. Well, nice being head over heels. I sleep when I should be awake. We eat spicy food and I drink far too much red wine. Not good, any of it. Before they came, I never had a free minute. Sonia and I used to work noses to the grindstone. Now this Sonia works. I just eat, sleep and drink. It's really not good at all.
It was never like this. All the morning, the tea boy is away for the professor, and he dozes in bed. Till noon. We used to have lunch at 1, like decent people. They wanted at 6. And all the night he's busy with his reading and his writing, then suddenly, long after midnight, the bell. What is it? What is it? The professor wants his tea. So we all get up, light the samovar. It was never like this.
How long are they going to stay?
Tea, ladies and gentlemen?
My friends, I'll take my tea in the study. There are some matters which require my attention this afternoon.
You'll enjoy a walk among our new trees. I know you will, Father. No, you will.
It's hot in this heat. But our great man of learning wears gloves, an overcoat, galoshes, and sports umbrella.
You like to take care of himself. What's wrong with that?
She is exquisite. Never before in my life have I seen such an exquisite woman.
I drive across the field, Marina Tenefeevna, or I lie in this shady garden, or catch a glimpse of this table. I don't have words for how I feel. Bliss! The weather's sublime, the birds sing, we live in peace and harmony. What more can one ask for? Oh, I'm deeply grateful.
Such a... such exquisite time.
Vine, amuse us. There's something you must have happened.
Oh, nothing. Everything's old. I haven't changed my clothes, I've gotten worse. Got lazy. I slouch about and complain all day. As for my moldy jackdaw, she doesn't change. She still picks up a scrap from one book and a scrap from another, coying,
"Women's emancipation! Women's emancipation!"
Got one eye on the grave and the other searching for the dawn of a new life.
And the professor?
And the professor? Oh, he doesn't change. He hides away in his study from dawn to the dead of night. His pencil is poised to skip from left to right. His eyes ablaze with inspiration's light. Yet none but he will read the word he'll write. Read for the poor paper. Now you see, what's he also write? Is his autobiography? Now there's an interesting subject. Retired academic. What does that make you think of? Right across the bread. Learned an old habit. He's got gout, rheumatism, migraine. His liver's all beaten up with envy and jealousy. This old fish lives on an estate that belongs to his first wife. Not that he has any desire to live there. Oh, no. He does so because he can no longer afford his house in the town. And yet he's constantly wailing,
"How lucky I am!"
And in fact, he's the luckiest man alive. Let me tell you how that is. Who is he? I know. A son of a sexton. From a seminary in some godforsaken village he soars. Becomes an academic at the university. Then a professor. Then he marries the daughter of a member of the Senate. He's this and he's that. And at heart, it's meaningless. Why? Because for 25 years he's been writing and lecturing on aesthetics and he doesn't know the first thing about it. 25 years regurgitating other people's ideas on realism, naturalism, and so on and so forth. 25 years of putting forth what, if you're an intelligent man, well, but if you're a fool, you don't wish to know anything. 25 years pouring water from one empty bucket into another. But you see his conceit, his self-importance. Now he's retired, well, it turns out not a soul serves him. He's the most obscure human being ever lived. Which means for 25 years he's stolen a place in the world that belonged to someone else. Oh, but you see how he strides up and down like a titan.
You don't by any chance envy?
Oh, of course I envy. The success he's had with me. Don Juan never had so many trials. His first one, my sister. Adorable woman, gentle, pure as the sky is blue, generous, warm-hearted. Why, I mean, she had more admirers than me, than these astutes of his. Yet she loved him with the love that angels say for those as pure as themselves. Then there's my mother. She worships him. To her, every inch of his being is sacred. Second wife, look for yourself. Beautiful and intelligent. Married him even though he's God knows how old. She's thrown away her freedom, her youth, her beauty, the joie de vivre. I mean, why? What for? Yes, she may not. Regrettably, she is.
Why regrettably?
Because faithfulness like that is a lie. It's a show. Oh, it's all very impressive, but it makes no sense. Be unfaithful to a decrepit old record in the spark club. That's immoral. But to sacrifice your youth, to stifle your most tender feelings, That's Marathi?
My dear Vanya, it's awful when you talk like that. Really? Now everyone agrees, a person who betrays their wife or their husband can't be trusted in any way. Who knows? They could go on to betray their country.
Oh, turn the tap on, pineapple.
No, I'm sorry, Vanya. The day after my wedding, my wife ran away with the man she loved. Her reason was my unattractive appearance. Even so, I would never betray her. I love her. I'm faithful to her. I help in every way I can. Every penny I have goes to looking after the children she had with her lover. I lost my happiness, but not my pride. And her? Her youth has gone. Nature follows its course. Her beauty has faded. The man she loved is no more. So what has she left?
Nanny, there are presents at the gate. See what they want, huh?
I'm here to see your husband. You sent me a note. He's grievously ill. Rumoured he's had something else. His house seems better.
Well, last night he was low, and he complained his legs hurt. But today...
So I galloped 20 miles as far as my horse will go. Oh well, it's not the first time. But now I'm here. I'll stay. I get a good night's sleep. As much as is required as we ride in our medicine bottles.
I'm so pleased. You never spend the night with us. I don't suppose you have lunch?
No.
Then stay and eat with us. These days we have it late, after 6. Oh, the tea's cold.
The temperature's dropped all the way down.
Never mind, Barney Barnett. We will drink it cold.
Forgive me, Yelena Andreevna. I'm not Ivan Ilyich. I am Ilya Ilyich Telyagin, or, as some call me, on account of these pockmarks on my face, pineapple. I am Sonya's godfather. Your husband knows precisely who I am. For some time, Yelena Andreevna, I've lived on this estate. Perhaps you'll notice, if you glance around the dining table, I'm there every day.
Ilya Ilyich is our friend of my What tea, godfather?
Oh!
Granny?
I forgot to tell Alexander. My memory is appalling. Today I had a letter from Pavel Alexeyevich. He sends his regards and his new pamphlet.
Is it interesting?
Interesting, but in a way strange. He refutes the very arguments that 7 years ago he proposed. It's dreadful.
Oh, it's not dreadful at all, Maman. Drink your tea.
No, I want to talk.
We talked and talked and read pamphlets for over half a century. Do you think it's about time we stopped?
You seem to find listening to me a burden. Forgive me, Jean, but over the past year you've changed so much I hardly know you. You were always cheerful, sure of your own mind, a guiding light.
A guiding light? For whom? A guiding light. Mother, why do you make such a tremendous joke? 47 years old.
Huh?
And yes, up until the year ago, I was just like you. I used to blind myself with interesting ideas, so as not to see the world as it really is. And I thought I was doing right. But now, if you only knew, I can't sleep at night. My mind is full of rage and anguish, and stupidly I've let my life slip away. In all these years, I could have had what I wanted to. Now I can't, I'm old.
Uncle Vanya. Can't you say something we haven't heard?
You're unhappy about something and you want to lay the blame on your beliefs. But the fault isn't with them. It's with you. You forget. Ideas in themselves are nothing. Thin air. You should have acted on them. Done something.
Done something? Yes, well, we all can't be a writing machine like your hair, Professor Squibble.
What point are you trying to make?
Tranny. Uncle Vanya, please.
All right. I'll be silent. So
silent and sorry.
What perfect weather it is. No too hot.
Yes. Perfect weather to hang oneself.
Nanny, what do the peasants want? It's always the same thing. They want to rent their bit of a new square.
Is the doctor here? Mikhail Pavlovich, they've come to fetch you.
From?
The factory.
I'm extremely grateful to you. Well then, time to go.
How annoying for you, but you'll be back in time to meet with us.
No, it'll be too late. Oh well, if you're not now, it will come. Be not to come. Tell you what though, I wouldn't say no to a glass of vodka. If it be not now. Here, Sofsky, I've got to explain. There's a man with no talent. That's me. Someday you paid me a visit with Sonia. I'd be delighted. It's a small estate about that big. This is interesting. I have an orchard and a nursery like which you won't find for 1,000 miles. Next door was a forest, a plantation. It belongs to the government. The forest is an old man, always ill, so I take a charge.
Oh yes, I've heard all about your love of the forest. No doubt the work you do there is useful, but doesn't it get in the way of your real work? You are a doctor, after all.
Only God knows what our real work is.
Would you find it absorbing?
Oh, profoundly absorbing.
You're a young man. You seem, I'd say, 36. Can it be as absorbing as all that? One forest after another. Don't you find it repetitive?
Oh, no. No, it's very interesting. Every year he plants new trees. The old forests are being destroyed. He'll do anything to stop it. If you'd only listen to him, you'd agree with every word he says. For a start, forests make the countryside beautiful. They teach us what beauty is. They inspire us to look into everything more deeply. Where the climate is harsh, forests soften it. In milder climates, less energy needs to be spent in the struggle with nature, so the people who live there are more sensitive. They're healthy, warm-hearted, generous with each other. They move with grace, their speech is refined. Science and the arts race ahead. They puzzle about life, but not in a gloomy way. They're gentle towards women.
Bravo, bravo.
Absolutely charming, my dear. But I don't believe a word of it.
Which is why, my friend, you should have to turn your head the other way when I put the logs on my stone and build my barns out of timber.
Burn coal in your stove and build your barn with stone. No. If you need to cut down a tree or two, cut them down. But why destroy whole forests? Our forests are splintering out of the air. Trees are torn down by the mill. The homes of wild animals and birds ripped apart. Rivers run dry. Landscapes that will make your heart vanish forever. And why? Because man has the sense. It's too late to bend down and gather the fuel that's lying at his feet. Richard. Take some, it's beautiful, and burn it in a stone to destroy what it can create. It's the act of a barbarian. Why would we give brains and the power to create so it can take what we find around us and make more of it? A man creates nothing. Forests will appear, rivers dry up, wild animals now, the climate's ruined. Each day the earth becomes more ugly. And you sit there and grin as though everything I say is a huge joke. Maybe I'm upset or pink-headed. But when I drive past woods, a safe or a path,
or hear leaves rustling in the forest, I planted with my own hands. I know that. Not entirely. But to some extent, the climate is under my control. If in 1,000 years, man has at last learned to be happy, it will be, in part, due to me. I plant the birch. I watch it sway in the wind. My soul bursts with pride life.
Anyhow, time to go. Yes. I'm obsessive, I suppose. My friends, adieu.
When will we see you again?
Who knows?
Will it be another month? And once again, your behaviour has been impossible? Did you have to antagonise your mother with all that nonsense about a writing machine? And this morning at breakfast. But I do believe you picked another quarrel with my husband. It's all so small, I know.
Yes, but what if I simply loathe him?
Please. There's no point in loathing Alexander. He's no different from anyone else. He's certainly no worse than you are.
I wish you could see your expression. The way you move. What a method it takes for you to live. It's a huge effort.
Life is a huge effort. And a bore. The way everyone picks on my husband. And everyone looks at me with such sympathy. Oh, the poor thing, married to such an old man. Your sympathy. I'll tell you what it is. Well, it's just like Astrov said. You thoughtlessly destroy the forests. In a while, there'll be nothing left on the face of the earth. In just the same way, you destroy human beings. And soon, thanks to you, there will be no faithfulness, no morality. Will anyone know what self-sacrifice means? If a woman doesn't belong to you, why can't you look at her then turn away? Because, and that doctor's quite right about this, there's a dim of destructiveness digging away in all of you. You feel compassion for nothing. Not the forests, not the birds, not for women, not even for each other.
Don't believe a single word you say.
And that doctor's face looks exhausted, but sensitive. An interesting face. Well, it's quite obvious Sonia's attracted to him. No, I do believe she's in love with him. Well, it isn't hard to understand. Since I've been here, he's visited 3 times. But I haven't once had a proper conversation with him, and I've barely been civil. So no doubt he imagines I'm bad tempered. Perhaps that is the reason you and I are such good friends, Because we are both trivial human beings. Oh, please, don't look at me like that. Stand.
How else am I supposed to meet you? I love you. You were free to give happiness to mine. Oh, I know there's always no chance of feeling the same way as I am. Just let me gaze upon you. Listen to your voice.
Shh! They will hear you.
Oh, don't send me away. I just want to tell you how I love you. It's making us speak to me.
Please. Happy. Stop! This is torture.
Thank you.
there. Sonia, is that you?
It's me.
Yelena.
Oh, the pain is unbearable.
Oh, darling, your rug's on the floor. I must shut the window.
No, no, it's suffocating. I dozed off a moment ago and dreamed that my left leg didn't belong to me. The pain woke me. It was agonizing. It's not gout, it feels more like rheumatism. What time is it? In the morning. See if there's a copy of Batyushkov in the library.
What did you say?
In the morning. See if we have a copy of Batyushkov. You'll find him with the rest of the poetry. I haven't read him since I was 18. Why can't I breathe?
Well, you're exhausted. This is the second night in a row that you haven't slept.
They say Turgenev had gout and it gave him his heart attack. Will that happen to me? Old age is insufferable. To hell with it! Even to myself, I'm repulsive. And all of you, you've only to look at me, you feel nauseous.
Well, you would think old age was something that we have done to you.
I'm even more disgusting to you than to the rest of them. Tell the truth. Which is perfectly reasonable. I'm not an idiot. You're young, vibrant, beautiful. You want to live? I'm virtually a corpse. I couldn't agree more. It's absurd. I'm still alive. Wait. I won't last long. Soon you'll be free.
Oh, I've had all I can take. For God's sake, quiet.
There you are, exactly. It's my fault everyone's worn out and bored to tears. You're all wasting your youth and I. Only I thoroughly enjoy myself.
Oh, please stop it. You're squeezing the life out of me.
I've done that to all of you. It's a well-known fact.
God, this is unbearable. Please, what do you want?
Nothing.
And say nothing. Please.
Isn't it strange? Vanya opens his mouth. Oh, that old fool, his mother. No one complains. Everyone listens. I say one word. Faces fall. The sound of my voice is enough. The truth, I suppose, is there's not much to like about me. I'm self-obsessed. I'm a bully. But aren't I entitled at my time of life to some peace and quiet? Aren't I entitled to a little care and attention?
Oh, no one disputes that. The wind's getting up. I must shut the window.
No, no, leave it. I insist.
Well, what's yours is yours. No one disputes that.
I devoted my whole life to learning. The study and the lecture hall are my home. I never doubted for a moment the esteem of my colleagues. Then, suddenly, for no reason, I find myself walled up in this tomb. Every person I meet is a cretin. Every conversation I hear, second rate. I want to live. I love praise, success, being made a great fuss of. Here, it's like exile. I want my life. Read how brilliantly the others are doing when all that's coming for me is death. I can't do it. I don't have the strength to be attacked because I've got old.
Oh, be patient. In 5 or 6 years, I'll be old too.
Father, you told me to send for Dr. Astroff. Now he's here, you won't see him. It's such bad manners. He's come all this way for nothing.
What could your Astroff do me? He knows less about medicine than I do about astronomy.
We can't pull out the whole medical faculty just for your gout.
He's like one of those simpletons who wander around blessing everything. time is it now?
It's after 12.
I can't breathe. Sonia, I dropped from the table.
When my soul is on fire. But you must
stop it! Go away.
In a while the storm will pass. And everything in nature will be refreshed and breathe more easily. It won't refresh me. Day and night I've cooped up in this house like some dumb boy calling in spirit. I can't get out the front door and I can't get out the back. I'm suffocating because I have no life. My past is empty, stupidly dribbled away on nothing. My present meaning terrifies me. Oh, look, Elena. Here is my love, here is my life. What am I to do with them? My feelings, my senses, they're as sharp as knives, but I've got nothing to use them on. I'm like a ray of sunlight falling to the deep.